Okay, so let's get started. Yeah, so it's a continuation on this lecture on the experimental results from the LHC. In fact, of course, I haven't talked about all results. The idea is to focus on the measurement of the W mass. And well, at the end, we'll also discuss a little bit measurement of the top quark mass. And of course, this is a very challenging problem at the LHC. And the main reason that you have to model W production quite accurately, because you cannot reconstruct neutrinos, so you cannot really fully reconstruct invariant mass. So you rely on the scattered only on the decay lepton, and that means that you have to model production of the W. And the idea is to get as much information as possible about the production based on some auxiliary measurements, for example, by comparing Z and the virtual photon production in Drell-Young, you can perform some PDF decomposition, so also including some sensitivity to valence quarks and all to the strange quark density. So then, okay, in the last lecture, I also briefly discussed how do we perform the measurement. And why it's actually so, how we calibrate the detector, what are the physics channels we use for that, and how actually that this depends also on the modeling. And yeah, of course, what we measure is not exactly what you predict in the theory. So it introduced this fiducial cross sections. I believe you will have many more discussions on that from John in the lectures tomorrow and the day after, but okay, this was necessary for this particular talk. So this fiducial cross-section has a relatively small dependence on the model. By the way, it's defined, but still there is a dependence. So it looks nice. So then I talked about unfolding and that it's necessary because of the detector resolution effects, and in certain cases it's perhaps a small effect. And of course, one of the key measurements for this precision key issues for the precision measurements is that we have to deal with systematic uncertainties, and this is making full description of the data rather complex with hundreds of nuisance parameters to describe it, just a couple of data points sometimes. And right, so we talked about nice features that you can do cross checks if you measure in different channels. And we attempted to do some PDF analysis using precision measurements of the W and Z cross sections. But then we got into a trouble that even if we have this very nice thermal level accuracy for the data, and we think that we use a really very good theory, which is next to leading order QCD plus next to leading order electrovics, we get actually quite a bad chi-square. And this turns out to be likely an issue of the fiducial cuts. So there's a mismatch between data and theory, because the theory expects something which is at least integrated fully in PT, and our measurement, because of the fiducial cuts, introduces some biases to that. So we saw that one can way to correct that would be to use resummation, which was actually discussed in the evening, that it's a good thing to do, but there are also some additional uncertainties which show up in this prescription. So fixed order is well defined, and ambiguous procedures. Here you have matching, you have recoil prescriptions. So several issues which needs to be dealt with. And okay, and so this was the end of the last presentation. So the other way is to try to avoid this fiducial problems is actually to do a better, more suited for comparison to next to leading order predictions to improve the way we do measurements. Okay, so let's start the new topic. And actually the thing we do, we for the neutral current relyan, we just consider adding additional dimension, which will be decay angle of the Z boson. So I mean, so the decay angle of the electron or muon in the final state. So as usual, right, so several ways to do that. So you can do it, introduce different frames in which you look at this decay angle. So traditionally, this will, so, well, it's probably best suited for hadron collider as a Collins upper frame. So essentially you have two protons, and then you have, of course, some PT of the Z boson, and then you essentially define the Z axis, which bisects this, this angle. So if there is no PT, the Z axis is essentially along the Z axis of the beams, colliding beams, and well, corresponds to the Z axis of the experiment. And then you look at the theta angle with respect to the Z axis. Okay, and you look at the cross-section differential on that, not integrated anymore. And as before, you have the photon exchange interference and the Z term. And okay, and immediately there are, okay, so this additional, okay, so that you have two types of terms, the cos theta squared and the linear and cos theta. So before, when we integrated in cos theta, only terms proportional to, well, to unity or cos theta squared, remained, and now we have also linear and cos theta remaining. And this is actually quite nice because we suddenly have couplings to axial couplings of leptons and quarks, which actually enhance contribution from the interference, so we can use it. Also, we have this particular combination of vector and axial couplings, which gives you additional sensitivity to the Weinberg angle. So this is the precision measurement which you can perform at the dipole. Okay, so this is additional information for the PDFs from the interference, because there are different couplings to quarks. Additional physics information for the standard model. But there is yet another feature. If you look at this plot for the angular distribution, so it's kind of obvious. So consider that we are at zero PT, that the Z axis corresponds to the detector axis. So it means if we are at cos theta around zero, we have lepton pair which is scattered, the Z boson decaying into kind of in the central region of the detector. On the other hand, if the cos theta is large, then it's likely that leptons are actually escaping the detection, and acceptance for them is quite low. But the key point here is that for small values of cos theta, the detector acceptance should be quite good. And this is actually what we see here is the leading order description, right? So that there is a hope that we can have a region in the phase space which will be fully contained inside the detector and would not care about fiducial cuts as long as we are at this cos theta. Okay, so all right, this type of measurement, which is differential in invariant mass rapidity and cos theta star in the Collins upper frame, was performed by Atlas and using ATA data. And okay, there's some slices. So this measurement is performed from 46 to 200 GeV. So just slices from 66 to 80. So then around the peak 18 to 91 and 91 to 102 are shown. So just can focus on them. Right, so everything is shown as a function of rapidity of the dilepton pair. And what you also see that this open and closed circles correspond to different values of cos theta, so positive or negative. And okay, so the first thing you see from the plot that when we are below the Z mass peak, that there is a difference in the cross section for positive and negative cos theta, same absolute value but a different sign. And this is actually classical for backward asymmetry. And as we go in the mass, so just under the peak, it actually goes away basically, and then it changes the sign. So this is from the interference term, which so it just flips the sign because of that. Right. So the second feature, so here we compare to a power hack next to leading order Monte Carlo prediction. So it's actually rather reasonable description of the data throughout, although it becomes a bit more tricky at for the high rapidity values. So the next feature which you see that if you look at the cos theta at larger values compared to smaller values, there is a quite some reduction of the cross section, and in fact this to a large extent comes not from the actual drop of the cross section, but rather just an impact of the fiducial cast, that we have a smaller acceptance if we scatter at larger angles, let's say discussed just now. Okay, so right, and if we are in the good acceptance region, the description is quite all right, but if we are at the very edge, there are some troubles, which are up to 20% level. Okay, so this can be also, in fact, formalized a little bit, what are the good acceptance regions, which are not. So if we just look at the acceptance calculated using, for example, NN-LOWERJET program, which is a pure next to leading order code. So for this, in this case, so it's for inclusive cross section. So it's actually rather busy figure, and unfortunately not very good quality. I'm sorry about that, but and we'll try to explain what's going on. So what is shown here are these different invariant mass bins. So we go 46 to 66, and we go up to 200. And yes, so 46 to 66 is everywhere for different cos theta ranges. These are different colors, and so these are cos theta bins, but also we can say classify the bins are as fully allowed at leading order, partially allowed, so it's part of the phase space appears only at the next to leading order, or forbidden at leading order. So it's a variation of the acceptance. So these bins are covered in the data because there is a recoil of the Z with respect to a jet somewhere. So this is then at the leading order not possible. So acceptance is of course very low for fully forbidden, it gets lower for partially forbidden as well. The CL is quite low. But then there are still ranges of the measurements which are fully allowed and have had basically 100% acceptance for these fiducial cuts. And so this measurement should be really quite nice to be described by pure fixed order prediction. Okay. So this is a theory, and indeed, this was actually utilized, this feature was utilized in recent PDF analysis. So I show an example, MSHT 2020 fit to this data. And so what they did, following advice, they used only the bins with acceptance more than 95% in the default analysis. And also, all right, they integrated in cos theta such that they don't want to measure the Weinberg angle, they leave it to experiments that comes later. So okay, there is a preliminary result, but the paper is not yet published. Anyway, so if you look at the chi-square, it's actually not perfect still, but its p-value becomes acceptable. So they also tried to do an exercise in which they didn't exclude the beam sweep flow acceptance, and they tried to fit everything. And in this case, it's actually really quite bad. So chi square is two compared to 1 point something in this case. So this the quality of the chi square doesn't mean that the fit cannot describe the data. It potentially means that there is a tension between this data and some other data. And right, so what is shown here is actually this ratio of the strange core density over the U and DC. So this this is shown as a function of X at the starting scale of this PDF parameterization. And so it's interesting to see that with this Atlas data, you tend to prefer rather unsuppressed strange density at low X. So starting from 10 to the minus 2, it's more or less consistent with unity. While if you don't include the Atlas data, there is a very large uncertainty, and the fit actually prefers something which is quite a bit lower. And so this is something which is still under discussion, so this is kind of interesting, and it's also important for the W mass because the CS production of the W is sizable. It's a big fraction of the concept. Okay, so let's move on. So we can do more with the with this ZT case, if you go beyond cos theta, but we also look at our decay angles, which is the last one, which is essentially the angle between the production and decay plane. So, all right, so in QCD, we have, Z boson is produced in quark and quark annihilation, and then we have a decay into a lepton pair. And all right, so in QCD, there is a perfect factorization of these processes. So there is no interaction between initial state and final state. So the factorization is, of course, not perfect in nature. That you can have electroweak corrections which may couple final state leptons and quarks. So this is true. On the other hand, this is a quite small effect, especially at the Z peak. Okay, so if assuming the factorization is perfect, then what we have a vector particle which is with a certain polarization which decays into a lepton pair, and so this decay is in fact is then fully described by this. It's angular decomposition, so with a number of spherical harmonics. So this is then can be parameterized, perfectly parameterized as the following. So just a bunch of coefficients and the particular dependence on cos theta and on fine theta. So an example of these harmonics is shown here for so it's for some of these coefficients. So it's quite some funny structure dependence on phi and cos theta. But okay, so this decomposition is fully complete and valid in QCD to all orders because there is a perfect factorization of the production and decay processes. So the next point is to measure a coefficient in front of say parabola. So if you just focus on the cos theta, then you don't need to measure the whole parabola, you need just 3 points. So that means in principle, you don't need to perform a measurement in the full phase space to determine these coefficients. You can measure in the restricted phase space, but still without any uncertainty extrapolate to the full phase space. Okay, so this is very nice, but of course it has a few caveats. So this is all valid in QCD, but of course it's not fully valid in full standard model. So if you even QED correction start to break it, so you have to inside the measurement apply the QED correction. So this must be done at the board level, as I said. So you have to pay price that there is a model dependence with respect to the electrolyte, but on the other hand, there is this extrapolation to full phase space within the measurement, with potentially also improvement of the accuracy of the measurement. Okay, so now if we talk about QCD and the polarization and what type of coefficients are present, so at leading order, we have only forward-backward asymmetry, so the term which is proportional to cos theta, so just linear term. And at next to leading order, we have a production from, okay, so the T-channel and glue quark and quark and glue anti-quark, and so then we have all the coefficients from A0 to A4. And finally, at next to next to the corner, we have also this blue channels, and all the coefficients are present. So this is actually measuring of these coefficients by themselves is an interesting test of the QCD. Okay, so these measurements are performed by Atlas and CMS. So this is an example of A0, which is a kind of longitudinal polarization of the Z boson. And so, for example, on the right, let's just focus here. So we compare this measurement. So first of all, as I said, this coefficient appears only then you at non-zero PT, so then you recoil with respect to some jet activity, and then it actually saturates at unity, so at high PT. Right, and then if you compare to fixed order prediction, which is actually next to leading order only in this particular case. So it's next to leading order for inclusive production, but if as soon as you're at finite PT, this is just next to leading order. It's actually very good agreement already at next to leading order. Even leading order is able to describe the data quite well. So this is one of the best observables from the terms of the perturbative convergence. Okay, and this is actually also again important for W production because this is longitude. This can be, W is also polarized, so you have to take it out in the modeling. Okay, so now if we go to all our coefficients, there's A2. Okay. And all right, so at leading order, so A2 should be exactly equal to A0. And so if you look at the difference between the two, okay, it should be zero, but of course we are at LHC, higher order corrections are important. And what you measure is actually quite a bit larger. And the theory is struggling to describe it. So the data looks also interesting. So it's very smooth behavior. So this is an effect of the rather strong regularization. So this is about unfolding. Is it better to unregularize or not? So this is something to watch if you see these things. And but still there is a tension, but this is probably okay because as I said at leading order, this is exactly zero. This theory is, as I said, next to leading order only. So it's just leading order comparison, in fact. Okay, so you need higher orders to really check them. A4, so this A4 is sensitive to Weinberg angle. So it's interesting to look at the A4 evolution as a function of PT. So it's again, well described by the theory, as long as you have proper Weinberg angle in the theory. It's present at leading order, and then that's easier. And so it's interesting, it drops actually at high PT. They don't have A3 to which actually increases. And so if you want to measure Weinberg angle using high PT, you probably want to use A3 as well. And okay, it's A7 appears at only at next to next to leading order. And it's kind of small. And it's okay, because it's small, it's both data and theory, it's rather well described. Okay. So this is very nice. And this is another tool to do full phase space measurements, which are relatively with small model dependence. All right, so just maybe a remark, which is not absolutely relevant for the W mass measurement, but there is a nice side benefit from this longitudinal polarization measurement that you can have. That, okay, so this process, I mean, the polarization appears because you have contributions from gluon quark diagrams, and therefore it's sensitive to the gluon density. And so that you can try to see if it has some constraining power. Of course, you first want to verify that this data well described by the theory. And yeah, so if you take just Atlas results, this is chi-square is pretty good. For example, for CT18 and then lower PDF set. Okay, if you look at the Atlas published data, unfortunately, uncertainties are still quite large. So you need to do projections, what may happen if you improve. And so this you can do for round 2-3 or phase two. And what you see that indeed, if you do that, then there is actually very nice improvement of the gluon density. So it's now shown just uncertainty on the gluon density at the scale of roughly, yeah, so in between Higgs and WZ. And so the original uncertainty is this outer blue band, and even with 300, you reduce it quite a bit at certain depths. And right, and so full data set helps even further. What's also interesting is to see where is this particular X range is relevant. Okay, I will not scroll up, but you can do it afterwards. So if you look at this kinematic plot, which compares DIS and PP colliders, you can, from that plot, you can already map that this X range of 10 to the minus 2 is very relevant for the Higgs production. And indeed, if you do proper simulation, you see that the center production of Higgs is very much uncertainty from the PDFs is very much reduced if you do that. So if you can, from this exercise. So it's a clean process for the measurement of the gluon density and potentially with a very interesting impact for the Higgs production. Okay, let's move on. And okay, so the last item for the W. So right, so we got some hints how we do PDF decomposition. We know how we control the polarization. And in fact, for the polarization, the situation looks to be quite simple because it's very well described by the fixed order prediction. So we just need to use it. The last item is, of course, the PT of the W. Okay, so how do we do that? So, right, so we start with measuring of the PT of the Z boson. Okay, so it's just an example. So, of course, many measurements, 7, 8, and 13 TV, but I just selected 8. All right, so again, we do, it's in two channels, electron muon channel, there's a cross check, and also to improve accuracy. So in fact, in this case, agreement between these two measurements is excellent. So chi-square per degrees of freedom is 43 over 43. Right. And okay, so if you look at the shape of the distribution, so all right, so okay, this is fiducial. So this is with certain cuts, but So the shaping is mostly just the production. So it's not the effect of the fiducial cuts, but so there's this Jacobian Sudakov peak and then which is at that low PT and everything at this low PT, the shape of the distribution is actually driven by non-perturbative QCD, and then there is some effect of the resummation, and then at the very end, fixed order should work. So, I mean, you can compare to predictions from RESBOS, and this is rather old. So, there are better resound predictions on the market nowadays. But, okay. What you see, actually, this works quite okay for the low PT and doesn't quite work at high PT. I will not really come to that, but okay. So this could be also related to PDFs and higher order corrections. And so this is also matching is not perfect between resumed and fixed order predictions. Not bad, but not perfect. And of course, if we just take the plain theory, the uncertainty is huge, but given that the uncertainty on the data is much smaller, we can effectively constrain it very much by profiling to the state effectively. Okay, so the way the WMS measurement was done is not using RESBOS, but rather actually using PIFIA. So because with PIFIA, we can do quite a bit of tuning and using the tools available. And all right, so this is just a comparison of this ZPT distribution now for dressed muons only. Okay. And so this is, I believe, Rivet-based comparison. And you can compare to various tunes, Monash tune and others. And this Monash tune is more global tune. It tunes well to our stuff, but perhaps doesn't quite work for the ZPT. Although, of course, this is 10%. It's not a disaster, so it's not so bad. But of course, we need much better for the WMS. So we have to retune ourselves. And and so then at the end, we reach something which is so very nice in agreement with the data. All right, but we had to play with a few parameters which got quite different values, but fine. So the data have have enough constraining power to control them, and of course the residual uncertainties which are present after the profiling of these parameters are included in the estimations of WMS. Okay, so maybe one more component. So I said PDFs are understood, but of course we want to control, we want to cross-check them and measure better. And so one of the interesting ways to measure the strange quark distribution is to measure W plus charm production. So, okay, so you can probably as an exercise draw a diagram for that. And what you actually want to measure is not the W plus some jet in which you take the charm, but the rather difference between this particular charge combination. So you have a W of one charge and the charm jet of the opposite charge minus the same sign combination. So in this case, you suppress the contribution from the gluon splitting into, you subtract statistically the contribution from the gluon splitting into CC bar pair. Okay, and then you are basically sensitive to this process, which is, gluon strange production of WC. Okay, so then how do you measure it? You can measure it in two different ways. So of course, to build this difference, you need to measure not only charm jet, but you need also to measure the charge of this charm. And okay, one way is to measure the mesons to detect the jet. And the other one is to detect the soft muon, which is associated to this jet, so which is presumably from some semi-Leptonic decay of the D meson. Okay, there is of course a background in case of soft lepton from B jets, but this is small, and it's also a question for you to think why the W plus B is rather small compared to W plus C production. Okay, anyway, so these are results. And so this is again fiducial cross-sections compared to various predictions. And so actually want to stress that the data accuracy for all these measurements is quite nice. So the data is shown actually as a vertical line. So if you compare the predictions, uncertainties for the predictions are typically larger than for the data. And the leading uncertainty is actually fixed order. So this is n low prediction. So just scale variation of the leads to a large uncertainty. All right. And yeah, so at the end, you for Atlas, you prefer PDFs with large strangeness content. And on the other hand, for CMS, you want something else. And there is a bit of attention. But also, as I said, the accuracy of the prediction is actually not sufficient to really say anything at the moment compared to the data accuracy. So the way forward would be to go to next leading order for this. And in fact, this is recently calculated. And all right, and so uncertainties are reduced a lot. But there is a problem which we briefly discussed yesterday in the evening, that the next to leading order corrections are calculated for flavor KT algorithm, and the measurement uses anti-KT algorithm with radial matching of the heavy meson. So there is a mismatch between the two. And the reason why it's in the flavor KT and not anti-KT, because anti-KT apparently is not infrared safe beyond next to leading order. So this is an issue. So I don't know what to do exactly, but we do need to do something. So there are some ideas. For example, if you do just measurement of W plus D, which is actually even more accurate. So perhaps we can do a prediction which would also include charm fragmentation at the matching next to leading order. So avoid all the jet issues and just do that. So this would be perfect. So I hope this comes. Okay, right. So two words on valence quarks. So I said one of the benefits in doing the measurement of the Drellian differential and cos theta is access to the to the interference term, and then we have access to valence quarks, and indeed this is true. So if we look at the particular linear combination of the valence quarks, and we look at PDF eigenvectors which are mostly constrained by this data. And okay, so these are here. And if you just look at the projections of the U-valence quark, you see, yeah, the uncertainties can be reduced as you add more data. So this is one particular linear combination of U-valence and D-valence. So again, if you want, you can think why this particular linear combination is constrained by the forward-backward asymmetry data. But if you want to decompose it separately, U-valence and D-valence, you need another linear combination. This actually you need for W plus compared to W minus production. And the way to do it is to measure actually W charge asymmetry. So is actually sensitive to U valence minus D valence. So combining the two, you can decompose everything in principle. And so the measurements are normally performed as a direct cross-section measurement for each of the channels separately, and then you build in a symmetry, and then you can compare to predictions. Okay, so what you see here so a symmetry is increasing as a function of pseudorapidity of the lepton, at least in the range of the Atlas measurement. So it's afterwards, actually, something happens. If you look at the LHCb, it goes opposite. This is because of the polarization and decay angle of the lepton. But at this moment, we are more sensitive to the production of the W, and this is just the fact that there are two U-valence quarks compared to one D-valence quark. And this here, we are more sensitive to valence production compared to the central production, which is mostly by the C quarks. Okay, and this constraints, this linear combination, is more or less a complete story for the W mass. Everything is kind of decomposed. Okay, just very quickly, in fact. So how do we measure the mass experimentally? All right, so there are actually three ways to do that. So we don't reconstruct missing neutrino, we reconstruct only the lepton. Okay, but we can reconstruct missing transverse momentum. So this is what we can do. And we can use the lepton PT or ET. So this is one way. So just from the position of this Jacobian peak, it's very sensitive to the mass of the W. So leading order, it would be without QED corrections, it would be exactly at the half of the mass. So then the other one is same way, so from the missing ET. Of course, here it's more difficult, resolution is worse. And finally, you can build a transverse mass out of the two. And you can measure using that way. And if you look at the model dependence of the different observables, so the largest is for the measurements based on the PT of the lepton. On the other hand, it's the most precise experimentally. So the combination of the two is at the end is the best. And just to recap how the modeling is controlled. So we use PT, PFI tune for the PT, then we check that the PDFs are well understood in certain PDF sets. So actually for the Atlas result, CT10 and then lower was selected as the best fit to existing at that moment data. And for the polarization, so as I said, the key one, the longitudinal polarization is necessary, and this one is quite well measured. So it's quite well predicted by the fixed order prediction. So combining these three modeling into one model, you get a reliable prediction for the W production. Okay. And this you already saw. So we get at the end a result which is quite competitive compared to the Tevatron. Still worse, but it becomes quite competitive. Not so much worse, actually. Different issues. So experimental uncertainty is actually quite smaller compared to Tevatron. And unfortunately, the result is closer to the electric fit expectations. So it's more standard model like after this data were added. So I mean, now you also have a LHCb results, which is kind of similar. Okay, now the big picture, which you all already saw, so everything looks self-consistent. And now I will turn to the other item of this plot, the measurement of the top quark mass. Okay, of course, again, so for the top quark, we have quite some machinery, quite a lot of measurements since the discovery at the Tevatron. And yeah, so many of these measurements were improved and tuned, yeah, starting from CDF and D0. And then they, of course, were further retuned at the LHC. And so here you have a relatively recent summary of various results. And all right, so I think one of the features which you see here that the world combination, which is a couple of years ago, which has a quite some significant contribution from the Tevatron result, is higher than the most of the at least CMS measurements. And okay, ATLAS measurements, more accurate ones, also tend to be a bit lower, but not all of them. And okay, so you have a few techniques which are used. So right, so okay, so in top you have the WW and 2B jets, and so to measure. Okay, so the cleanest sample is dileptin, but it has larger uncertainties. All jets actually surprisingly good, but one can argue what about jet energy scale uncertainty. On top of all that, all these measurements use the template methods, and so they rely on modeling of the top in the Monte Carlo. And okay, there is quite some discussion how much of this model uncertainty affecting this particular result. And okay, so one way, this in many cases the systematic limitation for these results at the end, and so I think you want to do something else. So having in mind this, so yeah, alternative methods are very interesting. And yeah, so one of the way to do it in alternatively is to use the fact that the TT bar cross section depends strongly on the top mass. Okay, so all right, so here we also have quite some machinery at the LHC and also the Tevatron. So we have a few very nice accurate measurements of the TT bar cross section, which is in fact in most of the cases is extrapolated to the full phase space. It's, okay, something for discussion. So if you look at the most accurate results from ATLAS, so it uses this EMU channel. So that means it's actually, in some sense, experimentally, so you have two leptons in the final state plus two B jets. In some sense, it's similar to Drellian. So the experimental uncertainties are quite similar. And right, but of course, there are additional uncertainties related to B jets, but there are tricks to calibrate them with the data-driven way. So essentially, there is a fraction of events in which you reconstruct both jets. So you can reconstruct only one of them, and then you can do, given a clean selection of this EMU channel, so with low background, you can cross-calibrate the efficiency to reconstruct a B jet and data in Monte Carlo, yeah, using this so-called tug and probe method. Okay, at the end, you get accuracy, which is, as I said, a percent level, very similar to Drellian. So this is very nice. Sometimes you also can get with jets quite good accuracy, which has an advantage that you have higher statistics of the sample. All right, again, so if you look at the comparison between data, various measurements and the theory, there is a tendency that the theory actually overestimates. So how it can overestimate, I mean, of course, it's all within uncertainties, but maybe slightly overestimates. So look, the cross section becomes larger if the mass is lower, and if the it also becomes larger if the gluon density is larger, and also the same way if the alpha s is larger, then the cross section becomes larger. So this overestimation could be, for example, too large gluon density or too large alpha s, or too low top quark mass. Okay, so it's, of course, you want to use all measurements and different centers of mass energy. They are actually of similar accuracy. So there is this some small experimental issue that luminosity uncertainty for each of them is the correlation is not fully known. So, but there is an experimental trick to do that. And the trick is to look actually at the ratio of the TT bar over the Z cross section. So as I said, so TT bar in dielectron channel, EMU channel in particular, is in fact very similar to the Z in which you, all right, you actually measure two electrons or two muons, but you can mix them together and then build something which to first order cancels experimental uncertainty. And as I said, B-jets can be cross-calibrated data-driven way. So it's actually, it's a very accurate result. So for example, this 13 TV measurement of this ratio. So this is with small luminosity. So statistical uncertainty can be improved. But right, so if you compare to the uncertainties of the predictions, which are in fact dominated in this case by the PDF uncertainties, it's not bad, it's comparable. It's also interesting to look at the correlation of the of these two measurements, and you see that there is a clear constraining power for this. Okay, so you can also look at that as a default taking ratio. So, right, so this is just a prediction. So this is a cross section for the Z compared to a cross section of the TT bar production. So, and as a function of center of mass energy reversed, so 13 TV, first 8, 7. Okay. And this is compared to different PDF predictions. It's interesting to see that for the Z production, most of the PDFs are sort of underestimating the cross section, while for the TT bar, it's opposite. And so it's all right, it's a good indication that something is going on with the quark PDFs, which are too low, and gluon PDF, which is too high. And actually, some PDFs got it right, so like Atlas PDF and Fiera PDF. And okay, there is this one outlier. But okay, so this is an interesting measurement, which is very sensitive to PDFs. And the other thing which you can see also that right, so that the measurements are very consistent as you look at the different center of mass energy. So this probably means that luminosity uncertainty is probably at least relative luminosity uncertainty between different center of mass energy is overestimated. Okay, but still this direct, if you want to measure top mass directly from the cross section, there is a strong coupling with alpha s and gluon, and this becomes a bit messy. So this is just a quick recap of that. So we can use the cross section as an alternative way to determine the top mass, just top. All right, large sensitivity to gluon distribution and alpha s. So we want to constrain that from the data. And of course, it's not only TT bar which is sensitive to alpha s and the gluon. We can try to use jet production for that. And all right, also instead of just total cross section, we may want to use differential distribution. And if we use normalized differential distribution, we may reduce correlations also. Okay, so this is basically the last measurement which I want to show you. So This is an inclusive jet measurement at 14 TV. This time to make a difference. So it's from CMS. Again, there is a long history of jet measurements from both Atlas and CMS. They are very nice and comprehensive, but okay, I just selected one to illustrate the procedure. Okay, so measurement. Okay, so at the LHC, that normally jet measurements are performed using anti-KT algorithm and with different radii. All right, so normally there are two radii which are used. So this 1.4 is actually, there was a bit of a discussion, but at the end we got it common between Atlas and CMS. And the higher radii are different, 0.6 compared to 0.7. Okay. And right, so the simplest measurement for the jets, it would be just inclusive jet measurement. So in each event, you count all jets. So, and right, and then you look double differentially in the jet PT and rapidity. Okay, so how do you measure that? You have to trigger them, and you have a set of triggers with low thresholds. Normally there are too many jets like that, and so you have to pre-scale. Don't take only fraction of events, but for high PT there are not so many, and then you can take all events. So in fact, you see luminosity of the measurement, it's corresponding only to highest PT jets. For low PT jets, luminosity is lower. And in case of CMS, they use a particle flow jet reconstruction, which combines both tracking and calorimeter information to improve resolution. Right, so you measure this at the detector level, but then you have to transfer it to the truth level. So this unfolding, which you need to perform. This is a very nice illustration of the unfolding. And okay, so this is what you see here is actually a transfer matrix for unfolding. So you have the truth PT jet, and then you can reconstruct it at the reconstruction level at different PT. So it's not a diagonal anymore, sometimes quite different. It's also, there is a migration, some migration in the rapidity, but okay, the angular information is much better, so migration rapidity is much smaller compared to migration in PT. Okay, so this is the matrix which you use. Right. So then you have to, what do you do? So then you have to base, all right, so one more remark here. So in fact, if you count number of bins at the truth level compared to reconstructed level, so you want to determine truth level PT, there is actually twice as many bins at the reconstructed level compared to the truth level. So it's no problem, you can do that. All right, and then, yeah, we just minimize the likelihood with respect to the counts in at the truth level using this transfer matrix. And at the end, so in this particular analysis, there is no regularization. It's really fully just inversion of the matrix. Or it's a solution of the system of the equation, which is a generalized inversion of the matrix. So the number of, it's the matrix is not quadratic. As I said, number of bins is different. So at the end, what you see is this, correlation matrix amongst the measurements. And right, so there is a typical pattern for the unregularized unfolding that next neighboring bins are having quite sizable anti-correlation. So it's order of 50% or more. This is usual, so this is what you expect, the migrations to the next neighbors, and then again it becomes positive. So the results may be scattered a little bit more because of that. On the other hand, at the end you will do interpretation fitting something smooth, so it's actually totally fine. So I think the unregularized unfolding is the way to go for the jet measurement. Now if you look at the decomposition of uncertainties, again, it's a typical picture. So statistical uncertainty is of course very important at high PT. So where you always need more data, there's never enough data at the very highest PT. But at the low PT, the cross section is large, so it's, there is no issue with statistics. The main issue is with the jet energy scale and jet energy resolution. Jet energy scale dominates, and yeah, so the systematics, which the main point, and yeah, the proper description of the systematics is the key point for a proper description of the data that you fit it to the theory. Okay, so before you fit the data to the theory, which is normally okay, so you want to compare to something which is fixed order, so you take next to leading order or next to leading order. Okay, in this particular case, I used NN-LOWERJET, which is included in so-called fast and low program. So this is, I probably don't have any time to discuss this, but this is actually huge development recently, very important. So we have ways to do, to have fast predictions, which can be, all right, so next to linear order calculations are very complex and slow, but with fast and low tables, you can obtain them very quickly for different PDFs. So you do it once for to prepare the tables, and then everything is much faster. Okay, so this is one set of predictions, and the other set will be next to leading order plus next to leading log for the jet radius and threshold resummation, and also electric corrections, which are actually quite important as well. All right, so then you have this fixed order, but still you have to do to apply non-perturbative corrections, because JETS also integrate some soft stuff which is not predicted and by the fixed order. And so the way it's done nowadays, so there were various techniques in the past, but nowadays what we normally do is we just take PIFI and we look at the ratio of the Herwig or our Monte Carlo, and actually it's used for uncertainty estimate. But what we do, we do PIFI with everything included, so multi-particle interaction and hadronization effects, plus parton showers over only parton showers. And so this is the effect of the correction. And then you can compare them for the different jet radii. And actually, this is very common picture. So the corrections are large for low PT. Obviously, soft stuff should be more important there. They become smaller at higher PT. And then there are opposite sign for the small and large radius. And perhaps maybe an optimal in between, and maybe Atlas was lucky selecting 0.6. Anyway, so 0.7 is preferred for the fixed order studies because, all right, so it degrades more. So there are less additional radiations if you look at the fixed order predictions. Now, just very quickly before I conclude, so we do comparison to the we can perform comparison to the theory, and it's actually pretty good. So it's quite reasonable agreement for the radius of 0.7 and this particular PDF set, and then we can essentially use this PDF set for the following analysis. So three types of analysis. So PDF profiling using this particular set as input, full PDF feeds using HERA data, CMS jet data, and TT-bar differential data. In fact, in addition, they performed analysis beyond standard model. So treating standard water effective theory and looking at some beyond standard model operators, dimension 6 in this particular case, together with PDF feed. So it's actually interesting because there is, whenever you do BSM interpretation of the experimental results, there is always a danger to have some hidden standard model assumption somewhere. So PDFs can be biased by the standard model feed. So you don't want that. And yeah, so if you perform the analysis without this, it's so if you can repeat PDF feed, including BSM, that's probably better. I will not discuss this, however. Okay, very briefly, but I think this is quite important. So just for people to understand, so what's the difference between the PDF feed and the PDF profiling, which is commonly used to constrain PDFs. So what is the PDF feed? So in the PDF feed, we actually, it's a full exercise. So we use PDFs and other parameters which we want to determine, parameterized at a certain scale. And then with a number of parameters, so for PDFs, depending on the PDF feed, it could be order of 50, or sometimes less. And then we evolve to higher, and sometimes more, we evolve to all higher scales, and we determine predictions for the cross section. So measurement is mu, then we have a prediction, and then we, of course, always have all experimental uncertainties here. Right, and so we do a full likelihood minimization. So. And it's a full exercise. We do all the evolution inside and calculations, the predictions inside. Okay, so this is the cleanest way to determine PDFs. On the other hand, it's also the most difficult, and it's also quite important to make sure that the data set which you feed is sufficient to constrain PDFs. So this is, okay, the best, but also the difficult. So then there is a shortcut. So you can use existing PDF set from the LHA PDF and essentially calculate predictions for this PDF set and for all the eigenvectors of this PDF set. And so then you can, instead of this full likelihood, you can build another likelihood which would compare the data to the prediction with the uncertainties according to this PDF eigenvectors, as you can do. And then you can minimize this likelihood with respect to, okay, the data uncertainties and the PDF uncertainties. Right. And this is the profiling. So then at the end, what you get is shifts of this nuisance parameters for PDFs, and this penalty term becomes more complex, and then you can interpret these shifts as actually redefined variables. Essentially, you can interpret the shifts as actually shifts of PDFs themselves. And this you can do because and you still have a valid PDF set, because if you take so this difference between the two PDF sets, all the integrals, all the sum rules are becoming zero. And then you can scale by any number and add back to a PDF set. And then you still get a valid according to DGLAB PDF set, because evolution is linear. So this you can do. So this is giving you back a totally valid PDF set. Right. So. Okay, so few slides.
Sasha, I think we will have to wrap it up quickly, because we're already running quite a bit late. And
right. Yeah. So
if you have any chance to
2 minutes.
Okay, thanks.
So yes, so we see that the data are sensitive to the gluon and can reduce uncertainties quite a bit. So just wanted to stress that it's also sensitive to alpha S, and it's actually focusing on next-to-next leading order results, you get a quite low value compared to world average at 118, and with rather small feed and scale uncertainty. So it becomes very interesting. So this is a tendency which we see nowadays, and we need to watch. Right, as I said, you want to measure TT bar differentially, so you can do it as a function of rapidity of the TT bar, and also in beams of MTT bar, which you have to reconstruct without assumption on the top mass if you want to be sensitive to the top mass. And then you can bean it also in number of jets, and you can feed it again. And again, you get a sensitivity to alpha S, which is again coming out rather low. All right. relation between the things is reduced, and just maybe to summarize. So you can then do a combined, unfortunately, only on low one, because for TT bar differential, we don't have next to next minimum order. You can combine the heat here, and you get a pretty good chi-square pair number of points for the CMS data. So also interesting feature here that the jet energy scale and resolution are important for both TT bar and jet measurements, but you can treat correlations properly since it's not often the case. And then at the end, at 10 low, you get, all right, FS closer to the normal one, and but very low and top pole mass with actually very competitive uncertainty. All right, and scale uncertainties are fully included. So it's, I think this is very intriguing and interesting one way of going forward. And yeah, so if you, I think what we need to do is to go beyond next to leading order and see what happens. So maybe alpha S goes down and top mass goes a bit up. So that's it. So I'm wrapping up. This is left for the evening session.
Perfect. Thank you very much for this.
Sorry,
but okay. Yeah. Of LHC measurements. I think given the time, I would say if you're available in the evening, I would refer any questions to the evening session. I also don't see anything in the chat right now, any hands raised. So unless it's really urgent and anyone raises their hand in the next 5 seconds, I think we can discuss everything that you want to discuss in the evening in the recitation session. Okay.
Right. I think people leave for lunch.
Yes, I think everyone is probably leaving for lunch, and we see each other again in a bit over an hour for the afternoon session.
Okay.
Thanks, everyone, and thanks, Sasha, for your lectures. Bye bye.
Bye bye.